Good morning. It is good to see you this morning as we worship together at a distance. I hope your home is doing well health-wise, and I hope you're ready to just enter into the Lord's presence this morning. We look forward to what He has to share with us. Let me open us in a word of prayer as we begin our time together. Father God, we come before You this morning. Lord, though we are apart, we gather together here in Your presence, wherever we are. Lord, You called us the church. We are the church, no matter where we are. And this morning, Your church has expanded in region to a large location from where each and every person who makes up the church here is sitting this morning. And Lord, we just pray right now that You would just help us to just stop whatever we're doing, the busyness of life, the hecticness of the current situation that we're living in. Help us to just stop and put distractions aside. Help us to set aside the projects and the activities right now and just take a few minutes to worship together, to enter into Your presence, to allow You to be magnified through our lives. Help us right now to just consider all that You have for us and all that You have blessed us with so richly. Lord, we want to see the positive in what You're doing right now rather than living in the negative of the world. We need that. And so this morning, Lord, just draw us to You. Wrap Your arms around us and love on us this morning. And may our worship be honorable to You. May it lift You on high. Thank You, Lord, for Your love and Your presence with each and every one of us. We ask these things in Jesus' name and for His sake. Amen. Let me begin with a verse from Proverbs. Proverbs 12:25 says, "Anxiety in a man's heart weighs it down, but a good word makes it glad." That's what we want this morning, is a good word to encourage us and to build us up. And let's begin with a good word in a song. Mike, lead us as we worship together.
Praises rising, eyes are turning to You. We turn to You. Hope is stirring. When we see You, we find strength to face a day. In Your presence, all our fears are washed away, washed away. Hosanna, Hosanna, You are the God who saves us, worthy of all our praises. Hosanna, Hosanna, come have Your way among us. We welcome You here, Lord Jesus. Hear the sound of hearts return. Turn to You. In Your kingdom, broken lives are made new. You make us new. 'Cause when we see You, we find strength to face the day. In Your presence, all our fears are washed away, washed away. Hosanna, Hosanna, You are the God who saves us, worthy of all our praises. Hosanna, Hosanna, Come have your way among us. We welcome you here, Lord Jesus. 'Cause when we see you, we find strength to face a day. In your presence, all our fears are washed away. 'Cause when we see you, we find strength to face the day. In your presence, all our fears are washed away. Washed away, Hosanna, Hosanna. You are the God who saves us, worthy of all our praises. Hosanna, Hosanna. Come have your way among us. We welcome you here, Lord Jesus. Hosanna, 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 Hosanna. My Jesus, my Savior, Lord, there is none like you. My days I want to praise the wonders of your mighty love. My comfort, my shelter, tower of refuge and strength. Let every breath, all that I am, never cease to worship you. Shout to the Lord, all the earth, let us sing. Power and majesty, praise to the King. Mountains bow down and the seas will roar at the sound of your name. I sing for joy at the work of your hand. Forever I'll love you, forever I'll stand. Nothing compares to the promise I have in you. My Jesus, my Savior, Lord, there is none like you. All of my days I want to praise the wonders of your mighty love. My comfort, my shelter, tower of refuge and strength. Let every breath, all that I am, never cease to worship you. Shout to the Lord, all the earth, let us sing. Power and majesty, praise to the King. Mountains bow down and the seas will roar at the sound of your name. I sing for joy at the work of your hand. Forever I'll love you, forever I'll stand. Nothing compares to the promise I have in you. Nothing compares to the promise I have in you.
Let's pray together. Father God, right now, Lord, we pray that you would speak to us. Speak to us exactly where we are in this moment, in this time. Your word ministers to each and every one of us if we will but listen. And so I pray that we would do that this morning. Encourage us, challenge us, build us up, and make us more like our Savior, Jesus. We ask these things in His name. Amen. I wonder, have you had feelings of apprehension or dread lately? Do you have trouble concentrating? Are you feeling a bit tense and jumpy? Maybe anticipating the worst? Or maybe at times you feel like your mind's gone blank. You're watching for signs of danger everywhere. Your restlessness, and maybe a little bit irritable. You might say, who wouldn't be in times like these? And you're right. I have witnessed a lot of this as I've talked with different people over the past week. The truth of the matter is, these feelings are signs of anxiety. And these past days have created a great deal of this anxiety for many people. This morning, God has a word for anxiety. Now, you may wonder if we really need to consider how to handle anxiety when it is so justified with our society in such turmoil right now. Consider this, though. Anxiety will bring on several physical symptoms as well. These include a pounding heart, sweating, stomach upset or dizziness, frequent urination or diarrhea, shortness of breath, insomnia, fatigue, headaches, muscle tension, tremors, and twitches. As if our anxiety over the spread of this virus wasn't enough, now we have symptoms from our anxiety that could be confused with the symptoms of the virus itself. I'm not trying to get you worked up this morning and get you more anxious, but I want you to recognize what's happening. I want you to contemplate a little bit with me this morning and seek God's direction in how we handle the times that we're living in. We don't have to accept what the world throws upon us, because God wants more for us. The proverb we started our service with this morning speaks truth for us to consider. While an anxious heart does impact our lives, physically even, a message from God, a word from God, can take care of all of that. And it does. I'd like you, if you would, to open your Bibles this morning to the book of Philippians, chapter 4. Here we're going to hear from Paul regarding what God has to say about anxiety, about what many of us are dealing with today. We're in Philippians, chapter 4. We'll begin with verse 4, if you'll follow along as I read. Rejoice in the Lord always. Again, I will say, rejoice. Let your gentle spirit be known to all men. The Lord is near. Be anxious for nothing, but in everything, by prayer and supplication with thanksgiving, let your requests be made known to God. And the peace of God, which surpasses all comprehension, will guard your hearts and your minds in Christ Jesus. Finally, brethren, whatever is true, whatever is honorable, whatever is right, whatever is pure, whatever is lovely, whatever is of good repute, if there is any excellence and if anything worthy of praise, dwell on these things. The things that you have learned and received and heard and seen in me, practice these things, and the God of peace will be with you. Paul gives us four clear instructions here to live by. These instructions that he gives us will help us with our struggles that we're facing today, especially with anxiety. The first instruction he gives us is very direct. Rejoice. What does it mean to rejoice? To rejoice means to show great joy or delight. To show great joy and delight. You know, one of the easiest ways to overcome a tense situation is to add a little humor. Sometimes we don't react well when someone tries to insert a little humor into a situation where we're frustrated. But you know, God does not mean us to live in a way that we feel completely overcome. To rejoice, to show great joy and delight. While there are definitely times when this is more difficult than others, the fact is, if we choose, we can always find something to rejoice about. I spent some time with the Paul John and his family the past several days as he nears the end of his life here on earth. And in the midst of that, I want to share with you, I got to be a part of a worship service on Thursday night. Reading psalms, singing hymns. It was clear, even in the midst of difficult times, they were able to show great joy and delight as they shared in one another's lives. You see, for some of us, right now, we're living in frustration. The kids aren't going to school. Some of you aren't able to go to work. It's challenging to live 24/7 with anybody. Husbands and wives, sometimes you have to deal with that, don't you? We need a break every now and then, but situations like this don't afford us that. The question is, do we get frustrated with each other, or do we find ways to rejoice together, to celebrate, to play a game, to do something fun, just to do something we may not otherwise do? I missed out on it, but I guess Donna and the boys, the other day when I was at work, went down to the basement and, I don't know, played Ultimate Frisbee in the basement. I'm not sure how you do that in the basement, but they managed to do it. We find ways to show our joy, to be able to show our delight. It's a frame of mind, it's a perception that we choose to have. And I think we all need to learn to do that right now. That's why Paul says, he says, rejoice in the Lord always. I'll say it again, rejoice. Can you rejoice today? Can you take time and just think about things that bring joy into your life? You're together. You're healthy. You're experiencing the presence of God in ways that years ago we wouldn't have thought able to do. Worshiping together from distance. But Paul goes on after he tells us to rejoice and reminds us one of the ways we rejoice is recognizing that the Lord is near. Folks, please hear this. God has not left us or forsaken us. He is right here in the midst of this. And he is using this, as we talked about last week, for his good and his glory. But then Paul goes on, and the second thing he instructs us is reject anxiety. Now, sometimes that doesn't seem possible because anxiety is one of those things that seems to just overcome us and we feel helpless. But what Paul says is to be anxious for nothing. Nothing. Some of us have a hard time with that. Being anxious is most often a product of worrying. And we've talked about worrying before, but I want you to listen to this passage from Matthew chapter 6 that begins in verse 25, dealing specifically with this idea of worry. Jesus is speaking and he says, "For this reason I say to you, do not be worried about your life as to what you will eat or what you will drink, nor for your body as to what you will put on. Is not life more than food and the body more than clothing? Look at the birds of the air, that they do not sow nor reap nor gather into barns, and yet your heavenly Father feeds them. Are you not worth much more than they? And who of you, by being worried, can add a single hour to his life? And why are you worried about clothing? Observe how the lilies of the field grow. They do not toil, nor do they spin. Yet I say to you that not even Solomon in all his glory clothed himself like one of these. But if God so clothes the grass of the field, which is alive today and tomorrow is thrown into the furnace, will he not much more clothe you? You of little faith. Do not worry then, saying, 'What will we eat or what will we drink? Or what will we wear for clothing?' For the Gentiles eagerly seek all these things. For your heavenly Father knows that you need all these things. But seek first his kingdom and his righteousness, and all these things will be added to you. So don't worry about tomorrow, for tomorrow will care for itself. Each day has enough trouble of its own." I want you to think about this list of things that Jesus tells us not to worry about. Life. Food, drink, and your body. And might we add toilet paper to the list while we're at it? For some reason, we have allowed the world to cause us to worry about so much and be anxious about so much. I'm a little confused when I think about the things that we're worrying about. We've got to run at the store on all kinds of paper products. Why is that? Why do we feel the need to buy more than we've been using over the past year? And yet that's what many people are doing, out of fear, out of anxiety, out of worry. Jesus says, let the Gentiles, let those who don't know him worry about those things. You need to be secure in him. You need to trust in him. Again, this goes back to what we have talked about before, and we mentioned it last week, the idea of that Sabbath year when they had to trust that God would provide enough. Are you trusting in God? You need to reject anxiety. Don't allow the world to pull you in to get worried about all these little things. Life, God has given you that, and only God will take that. Food and drink, well, if you're running low and you can't get out and get some, then call us. Because that's what the church family is here to do, is to support one another. But most of us are doing okay. We're not running out of food. We're not running out of things to drink. So don't get worried about it. And clothing, well, you know, here we are. Some of you are sitting at home this morning. I'm still in my suit and tie just because I want some normalcy for us. Some of you may still be in your robe from this morning. Hard to say, but we worship together. We don't need to worry about the little things. You know, this list that Jesus gave us was not prepared for today, but it sure fits in the times that we're living, doesn't it? I'm challenged by his question. Can I add a single hour to my life by worrying, by being anxious? The answer is clearly no. Worrying and being anxious accomplishes absolutely nothing. But how do we pull ourselves out of this tool that the enemy is using so well in our lives? How do we overcome the fact that the enemy is causing us to be anxious about little things in our life? Well, Paul has the answer for that in this passage that we're looking at, and it's the next thing that he says, the next instruction he gives. Make requests to God. Make requests to God. This is done through prayer. Folks, we need to stop and we need to pray. I don't know what your prayer life has been like, but right now we need to continue to pray and we need to increase our time of prayer. We need to get together with our family and pray. We need to get in our closets and pray. We need to let God know the things that Satan is throwing up in our face that are causing us to be anxious. We need to give them to him and ask him to take that anxiety away. Talk to God about what you want. Talk to God about what we need. Daily I am praying that God continues to put a hedge of protection around my family. But not only my family, I am praying daily that God keeps a hedge of protection around our community. We are a blessed community right now, with the limit of this virus penetrating us. Let's pray together that God continues to protect us, that God continues to provide for us. Take your requests to him. That's the first step in rejecting anxiety. And then the fourth thing that Paul gives us instructions on is to dwell on the excellence and the praiseworthy. To dwell on the excellence and praiseworthy. One of the things that some of you need to do is you need to turn off the news. Some of you need to just shut the TV off, turn off the internet, and quit trying to find out all the details you possibly can. There's too much garbage out there. There's too much information that isn't factual out there. While we need to be informed on what to do, we need to limit it to what is right and true. You may ask, what in this world qualifies as excellent and praiseworthy? Well, Paul lists it here. Truth, that which is honorable, that which is right, that which is pure, that which is lovely, and of good repute. You see, by dwelling on such things, the list of worries seems to disappear. Dwell on the Word of God and watch those anxious thoughts flee. It's not as hard as we make it out. I know firsthand what it feels like to be overcome with anxiety. In those moments, bed often seems like the only viable solution and option, hoping the day will just go away when that anxiety overcomes you. But Paul tells us there is an answer that frees us. Remember what our salvation is about. It's about our freedom. We are not bound by sin any longer, but we are also not bound by the worries of this world any longer. Because the world is not in control of our lives. if we've turned that over to God. Anxiety can flee if we command it to. Take time to allow God to work in your life. Invest in His Word. Be encouraged. Find those things to rejoice in. Go to Him in prayer with your requests and find success in chasing anxiety away. Don't just succumb to it. Don't be apathetical in these times. The world will tell you you are justified in your anxiety. The world will tell you you are justified in your worry. The world will tell you that you just need to get all of this information and take every aspect of it and just run with it. Well, folks, you can live that way if you choose to. But normally, the only way you're going to fulfill that is building yourself a bomb shelter, getting enough food, and climbing in there and leaving the world completely and totally behind. And that's not life. That's not the life that God has for us, a full and meaningful life. It's time to live. There is nothing that is happening right now in our society that is shutting down your life. You choose how to live. You choose what is going to be in control of your life. This virus does not do that for you. While it is wise to take precautions, while we have had to make some adjustments, while Satan thought that he was going to have a victory by bringing a virus into our nation and shutting down the churches across this country, right now more than ever, people are hearing the Word of God. People that may never have heard it before, getting online and checking things out and stumbling across a worship service just like this. A word that is an encouragement to them. There may be people watching who have never graced and passed through the door of a church. And yet, in times like this, God has opened doors of opportunity for His Word and His good news to penetrate homes throughout the world. I hope you realize that what we're doing here in this time of worship through this live feed has opened the opportunity for people across the globe to be in worship with us right now. There's no limit to who could be joining us in this time of worship. Maybe God has called us to leave the four walls because we've become so comfortable within them. And He's got more in store for us than just what happens in this room. Let me leave you with this charge from Peter. It comes out of 1 Peter chapter 5, verses 6 through 11. Listen to the charge that he gives us. Therefore, humble yourselves under the mighty hand of God, that He may exalt you at the proper time, casting all your anxiety on Him, because He cares for you. Be of sober spirit, be on the alert. Your adversary, the devil, prowls around like a roaring lion, seeking someone to devour. But resist him, firm in your faith, knowing that the same experiences of suffering are being accomplished by your brethren who are in the world. After you have suffered for a little while, the God of all grace, who called you to His eternal glory in Christ, will Himself perfect, confirm, strengthen, and establish you. To Him be dominion forever and ever. Amen. You know this crisis will come to an end. You know God's not through with you, don't you? You know this is not the new norm, right? It's time to stop allowing Satan to control how we feel and how we live. He thrives on fear, and we are not called to live in fear. We are not called to live in anxiety. We are not called to live by worrying. We are free. He has given us that freedom for a full and meaningful life. God is blessing you right now. Are you seeing it? Are you taking time to recognize it? Are you rejoicing in it by showing your joy and your delight? If you're with someone right now, watching and worshiping with us, if someone's in the room with you right now, just look around at them. Give them a smile. Show them that this is not going to knock us down, because we're more than that. God is not through with you. Don't allow the world to keep you down during these times. This is the time for the people of God to shine brightly for His glory with His good news. Let me pray with you. Father God, I know, Lord, that it's easy for us to succumb to worry and anxiety. I know, Lord, that it's easy for the world to put pressure upon us. I know it's easy for us to allow ourselves to pursue more information and more information that just takes us farther and farther down. Lord, help us to have just enough information to know what we need to do. But help us to thrive on the Word of God. Your Word says, as newborn babes, desire the sincere milk of the Word that you may grow thereby. Help us to engage in your Word. Help us to own it. Help us to pursue you diligently, and anxiety will flee, worry will fade, and joy and delight will overcome us. What a wonderful time we're living in to experience your goodness as you bring us back together, as you put us where we need to be in one another's lives, considering others more important than ourselves, taking the time to make contact with each other, to check on each other, to show that we care. Lord, you have brought us right back to where you've wanted us to be. And Father, I pray that you will continue to protect us from this virus. I pray that you will remove it from the face of this planet. But in so doing, Lord, I pray that we will continue to be who you are calling us to be in the midst of this. That we will continue to stop the busyness of life and be concerned with our neighbor, our family, our friends. That we'll take time, even in difficult situations, to celebrate and worship together and rejoice. Rejoice in the Lord always. And again, I will say, rejoice. Father, help us to live that way and be glorified in your people today, that the world will see and hear the good news through how we choose to live. We pray these things in Jesus' name and for His sake. Amen. Mike's going to sing with us one more time here.
Think about His love. Think about His goodness. think about His grace that's brought us through. For as high as the heavens above, so great is the measure of our Father's love. Great is the measure of our Father's love. Think about His love. Think about His goodness. Think about His grace that's brought us through. For as high as the heavens above, so great is the measure of our Father's love. Great is the measure of our Father's love. Great is Thy faithfulness, O God, my Father. There is no shadow of turning with Thee. Thou changest not Thy compassions, they fail not. As Thou hast been, Thou forever wilt be. Great is Thy faithfulness, great is Thy faithfulness, morning by morning, new mercies I see. All I have needed Thy hand hath provided. Great is Thy faithfulness, great is Thy faithfulness, great is Thy faithfulness. Lord, unto me.
I hope that you have been blessed this morning by the presence of God. I hope that He has spoken to you and encouraged you. And I hope that He has given you the ability to live free as He intends for you to. I love you. I hope you have a wonderful week. We'll see you next week. God bless you.